Good evening. Prince Charles spoke today of the desperation felt by farmers coping with foot and mouth disease. Real difficulties which he said could end in suicide.
I don't know if you can see the changes that have come over me in these last few days. I've been afraid that I might drift away. So I've been telling old stories, singing songs that make me think about where I came from. And that's the reason why I seem so far away today. Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, and now I'm going home. For if I should become a stranger, you know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had.
It's a most extraordinary story, and it's quite unique, I think, you know, in Scotland and probably, you know, the rest of the UK and Europe. It really is the manifestation of a community's will to bring culture into an area that really desperately needed something just to lighten the heaviness of what was going on there.
I remember being in Castle Douglas and seeing a headline on the Galloway News, and it said, Glenkens Valley under threat. And that was a real defining moment, actually, because you suddenly thought, if there was a farm locally that was being tested for foot and mouth, if that had proved to be positive, there would have been no animals, no cows, no sheep in the whole of the Glenkens Valley. And it suddenly made one think, we must do something for the whole of our area and trying to pull together if we possibly could.
Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you called me, now I'm going home.
When the idea was first mooted way back in 2001 to do something with the old school building, it had been raised in a sort of community survey that something should be done with it, but nobody really had any idea what. And a few of us had got together, bandied some ideas about, met around people's kitchen tables, sometimes Dr. Sheila's, sometimes at Cathy's, sometimes in the fire station, I seem to remember.
Brian and he was Provost of New Galloway at the time. We talked. Then there was Melissa, and Melissa was working for the council. In fact, she still does. And she was hugely helpful and instrumental in us applying to the council right at the very start to get a tiny little bit of money. Then very scarily, I remember ringing up Anna Campbell, and I didn't know Anna very well at that point. And of course, there was Wendy Davis and Chris Mason, and when we came to the actual business of developing the old school, Chris was just terrific.
We were geographically challenged. Why should we have to go to the central belt to see things, bring them here? If we have a quality venue, people will come here to us.
And so we knew that there was a will and that people would like to see something done with the old school. So that, coupled with the whole pulling together of the Glenkens, made us think, let's do something that will be arts and community, because quite frankly, you cannot have one without the other. And that was really the impetus and the starting of the Glenkens Community and Arts Trust.
I mean, I grew up in Dumfries and Galloway. I grew up about 12 miles away near Castle Douglas. And we never had anything like CatStrand. And God, I wish we had. And there was nothing like it in Castle Douglas. I don't think there's anything like it in Castle Douglas to this day. In fact, I don't even think there's anything like it in Dumfries, necessarily. It's quite a unique little place.
There was three sets of plans. There was three options. We could have the cheaper option, which was just doing up the existing building, knocking down the old bits, and then doing it in phases. There was a kind of intermediate option, which was building a bit of an extension and then adding to it later. Or there was the full-blown thing, and everybody said at that, but why not go for the full thing?
I remember the very first meeting, we actually had it in the old, what was the old butcher's shop, and we took those over as our offices. But one Saturday morning, somebody just turned up saying, look, I'm on holiday here locally, I love the Glenkens, I'm interested in what you're doing about this project. I just wonder if my trust in London, who I work for, might be able to help you in some way. So that was the start of a fantastic relationship we had with something called the Headley Trust that supported us for the first 3 years. And that, without that, we couldn't have done it. It was the start of other people beginning to believe in us.
A lot of people said it was impossible, and a few of us maybe had doubts at that time as well, but we thought it through. The idea was good, we thought, and convincing other people wasn't too easy at the time.
I have moved and have kept on moving, proved the points that I need proving, lost the friends that I needed losing, found others on the way. I have kissed the ladies and left them crying, stolen dreams, yes, there's no denying. I have travelled hard, sometimes with conscience flying, somewhere with the wind. Let me tell you that I love you, that I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you called me, now I'm going home. For if I should become a stranger, you know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Fire, the empty room, the forest choir, the flames that couldn't get any higher, well, they've withered now, they've gone. But I'm steady thinking, my way is clear, and I know what I will do tomorrow. When the hands have shaken and the kisses flowed, well, I will disappear. Let me tell you that I love you, but I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me, and now I'm going home. For if I should become a stranger, know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had.
I remember the night well. My wife had asked me to turn my phone off the night before because I usually sleep with the phone beside my bed, and she said, it's really bad for you to have it on while you sleep. So I turned the phone off, and there was a message the next morning. It was Brian in a very, very calm voice just saying, well, I'm really sorry to have to say, but CatStrand was really badly flooded last night. If you want to come down and help, then please do. And I remember thinking, it doesn't sound that bad. It doesn't sound that serious. Maybe I'll just have a slice of toast and then, you know, donner on down and see what's going on. And I remember getting there, and it was just absolute carnage.
That benign burn that for 364 days of the year looks like it could cause no damage at all, you would not believe how bad things could actually be. It was as if the Aswan Dam had been breached at the back, and there was a raging torrent round the back of the building, and more importantly through the building.
To arrive in the CatStrand to be met
by that and all the shop stock floating out the door and floating down the street was heartbreaking. But we just had to get on with what we could do at the time, try and rescue what we could, secure anything else to stop it flooding, but it was just about an impossible task. And we were there most of the night doing that.
I remember about a week after the flood happened, we decided that it would be a good idea to sort out a fundraising campaign to try and get some donations in to help us with cash flow and whatever else. And we're like, right, great, we'll sort out a crowdfunding website or something. And I was tasked with this, and I remember saying to everyone, right, if you could all just send me some pictures of the flood that you took. And they all kind of, there was blank faces everywhere. Did you take any pictures? We didn't have a single picture. We didn't have any footage at all. Everyone had just totally mucked in and just got the job done and helped with the clear up. And not one person thought, oh, crap, I've got to Instagram this. Which I thought was actually pretty astonishing in this day and age.
You feel so helpless because I was in New Zealand and I knew loads of folks would be there lending a hand and clearing stuff up. So to some extent, I just couldn't wait to get back to see what was going to happen and how we were going to move forward. And running the Connecting in Retirement project, I thought, we do so many things at the CatStrand, you know, what are we going to do going forward? But what it did prove is the resilience of this community and the folks that took part in that project. As an example, ukulele band moved up to the Cross Keys and we used to practice there. And the writing group, one of the ladies said, oh, why don't we come round to my house? I've got a big house and a big table. So they all sat around there. And, you know, things like that, it was just great how people pulled together and moved forward. But every one of those groups just wanted to get involved and get the CatStrand back up and running.
It did attract a lot of media attention the next day. BBC were here, Border Television were here. But the most heartening thing, I think, the next morning was we've got a fantastic team of volunteers. And we had so many of them turning up at the door once the news spread through Facebook, etc. There were so many people arriving to offer their help that it was really reassuring, and we thought that was the spark to go on.
The response from the community, the need for the community, the love from the community for what we do made it absolutely apparent that no matter what, we had to get back up and running again.
There's a man I need. A couple of days after the flood, people had been bringing in all sorts of things that they'd been finding floating down the street, found them at the edge of the road somewhere, and people had brought in various bits of cuddly toys, and they brought a tray of our squeaky red kites that we used to sell in the shop, and they'd been sitting over in the corner for the last couple of days, and I was in the building on my own, I remember, a couple of days after the flood, and they'd obviously dried out enough by this time, and all of a sudden they started squeaking entirely on their own. So after I got over the initial shock of hearing that wee squeak from the corner of the shop, I saw that wee red kite squeaking as a sign that we should go on. And I'll sail around the west coast through villages and towns. I'll be on my holidays, they'll be doing the rounds. They'll ask me how I got it, I'll say, save my money. They say, isn't she pretty? That she called dignity. And I'm telling this story in a faraway sea, sipping down raki and reading me our keys. And I'm thinking about home and all that that means, and a place in the winter. We face a lot of challenges with the arts program, trying to get people to come to New Galloway. We got Ricky Ross because he was doing a solo tour where he was playing to 500, 600 people in each venue, and he wanted a warm-up show. And he put this on his website as kind of secret warm-up gig. And for us, it was the headline act of our Home and Dry Festival as we reopened after the flood. The look on the faces of some of the big acts that arrive at CatStrand, presumably expecting something much larger and much more prestigious, is often a picture.
I've thought about trying to capture it as they arrive on film.
Absolute memory from that night will be Dr. Jones appearing, having gone back home to get his LP to bring back down for Ricky Ross to autograph, which I thought was fantastic to see that kind of thing.
We've had some near disasters with artists. The most common one is they think we're in Castle Douglas. Some of them hope we're in Castle Douglas. But some of them have actually gone to Castle Douglas and phoned us up and gone, where is the venue? I remember Mark Steele did this, and the whole point of his show was that he did a show about the town he was going to, and he did his show about Castle Douglas, only to realise that he was actually playing in New Galloway, 13 miles north. And I remember him opening the show up with, yes, I'm really sorry, I thought the show was Castle Douglas, and I've done the show about Castle Douglas. I hope that's okay. And there was a kind of stony silence. But eventually the audience accepted him, and it was a fantastic night. He was hilarious.
One of my most memorable events I could remember was the Indian Brass Band that featured both inside and outside. Originally they were in the courtyard playing and caused quite a lot of consternation to anybody who was walking up and down the street. In fact, even when cars stopped to see what was happening.
And it still feels a little bit surreal, actually, sitting in New Galloway watching all these performers and musicians from all around the world performing right here in New Galloway.
There was AJ Croce, who played here in August, who clearly had no idea where CatStrand was, or his agent didn't. He's from Los Angeles, his label was in New York, and his manager was in Switzerland. They'd obviously heard about CatStrand and thought, somewhere between Glasgow and Edinburgh, perfect, we'll hit both camps in one go. And so AJ Croce came all the way from America to do a show in London at the O2 Academy, at Liverpool, the Philharmonic Hall, and CatStrand, Scotland. And so he arrived and he just couldn't really take it in. We walked onto stage and he sat down and he said, I don't really know how I got here. And I remember just sitting there going, neither do I. He'd got a taxi from Edinburgh Airport to CatStrand. And then the next morning he got a taxi from CatStrand to Liverpool Philharmonic Hall.
Who could write the script that a flamenco guitarist would sell out on a Monday at the CatStrand, New Galloway? Fantastic.
I don't expect the whole of the Glenkens to want to come to everything that I do. Nor do I aim for that. It would be impossible. Creative Scotland exists so that we can please as many different groups of people as possible, rather than just appealing to one group of people, which would be very, very easy, and you know, we would have great ticket sales and everything else. The trick is diversity and having lots of different things at different times of the year, and that often means that you will get people coming up to you and saying, why don't you have a bit more of this?
I do feel that initially we had a very strong focus on arts, which continues, but it's been so good to see the way that other elements have developed. Prime of those have been Brian Jones's project, initially Connecting in Retirement, moving on to the Connecting in Communities. It's also been great how the cafe has developed, the shop has developed, and very importantly how the transport initiative, GTI, has developed.
I think people just think, oh, it's CatStrand, you know, they just have to click their fingers and thousands of pounds worth of public money will come rolling in. It's not like that at all. We live very much hand to mouth. We spend most of our time doing funding applications, and it's a real struggle. It's a real struggle a lot of the time.
When I first came on board at GCAT, I was finance director, and being the sort of smart aleck banker coming in and thinking that everything had to add up on a standalone basis, looking back now, I was very naive and this just won't happen. We're very grateful for the continuing support from Creative Scotland. It's fantastic. Other things like the youth arts continue to be very well supported by Hollywood Trust, who have been fantastic supporters of ours from the start. We've had ongoing support from Big Lottery, Heritage Lottery for various projects.
We live off a combination of funding, goodwill, donations, revenue created by ticket sales, shop, cafe, art sales, but largely it's just the goodwill of people. It's just people who come to our shows. We can't really exist without them. If people don't use the CatStrand, it will just go away. There's no doubt about it. If there's no need for it, then nobody will fund it and nobody will make it happen.
Inevitably, things take off in ways that you don't expect. People come in ways that you don't expect. Money comes in ways that you don't expect. And the whole place has developed, I think, in a much stronger, much more positive way than we could ever have hoped for or ever have dreamed of.
People who remain nameless that said it would never work, but here we are. It did. 10 years on and we're still here.
If you just look in the visitor's book and when you see comments like, I just wish our community had a CatStrand too, it does make you feel good and it makes us as a community feel proud.
The most common question I get asked is, how does CatStrand exist? What do you do to make it exist? How does it exist in a village of 450 people with a catchment of 2,000 or whatever? It shouldn't work. How does it work? And the answer is, I have no idea.
Happy birthday, dear CatStrand!